Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Gathering Table, Growing Strong Relationships Through Food, Faith, and Hospitality by the Gingham Apron. Compiled by Baker Publishing Group. Contributions by Annie Boyd, Denise Herrick, Molly Herrick, Jenny Herrick, and Shelby Herrick. Narrated by Ann Richardson. Introduction. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Psalm 34, verse 8, English Standard Version. One Sunday afternoon in late spring, as the bright green grass returned, the five of us gathered together on the farm with our families. The smell of lilacs greeted us, and the beautiful bursts of pink peonies and roses welcomed us at the door. Farm life had awakened in full swing. Planting was finished, and the first cutting of hay was about to commence. We greeted each other with warm hugs and smiles. Cousins were ready to meet the new baby bottle calves Grandpa kept in the barn. Once the welcomes and excitement quieted a bit, we gathered for another family meal, something we have done for years that naturally follows alongside our family business and farming lifestyle. Each of us generally contributes a favorite family recipe. The kids usually come away with a new song, craft, or game they've learned. We embrace the scenery and landscape of the current season of life. After we finished our meal, we gals filled our coffee cups and headed into the living room. While sitting on the soft, pale yellow chairs, we leisurely discussed what seemed like an endless list of all of our favorite foods, and we realized just how many treasured family recipes we each brought to the table. Grandma Betty's potato salad and key lime pie, and Grandma Maxine's soft ginger cookies and peach cobbler, just to name a few. We are a modern-day, close-knit farm family, and each of these recipes comes with a special memory, and often a handwritten copy passed down through the generations. As our conversation continued, we dreamed of making a cookbook to record our heritage as it is expressed through food. Because of our farming lifestyle and the Iowa climate, the four seasons are prominent in our lives. They envelop us and affect what we eat in each season. Also, the memories these foods carry can bring us back to a specific occasion, so we knew that our cookbook would also have to be reflective of the changing seasons, just like our lives. Equally as prominent in our lifestyle are our family's strong ties to our faith, the foundation of our existence. God's plan of salvation through His Son, Jesus, is the imperative message not only for our family's future generations, but also for our listeners. We desire to cling to God's ways in our lifestyles and values, and we want to impress them upon our children throughout each day. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7. We could not write a book of family gatherings and recipes without also including our faith heritage. What began as a simple conversation on that sunny Sunday afternoon soon became an intentional project. With faith, family, and the seasons of life on our minds, we committed to plan, prepare, and collect writings from monthly gatherings throughout the course of an entire year. And so the year of gatherings began. The months came and went, and everyone in our family anticipated and started to love the gatherings. The kids began asking, "What are we going to do next month?" The cousins started to get to know each other better, the communication among us five girls became more frequent, and we were becoming better friends, not just family. The men in our family also found themselves especially enjoying some wonderful food, and fun locations too. After turning this whimsical plan into reality, we were truly astonished by the many blessings that came from our little cookbook project. It turned into rediscovering joy and fulfillment with God's vision for our relationships. Food and refreshment are just threads for connecting us. The gatherings are simply catalysts for cultivating strong families and relationships. God's design of hospitality, our acts of service, the love we show one another, and the pauses we take to make memories can have a profound impact on each one of us. You too can bring your family, your church group, or your neighborhood closer together through meaningful yet simple meals and gatherings. Jesus often taught his 12 disciples around the table or around a fresh-caught meal on the beach. We have even been called to remember his perfect life and sacrifice for our sins through food elements, the bread and cup of communion. Something special happens when we gather, pause, and are refreshed by good food and conversation. We Gingham Apron ladies hope to inspire you to gather around your tables, to slow down and embrace the richness of your relationships. We urge you to let go of the Pinterest perfect ideas and instead honor God by seeking and initiating time with others to create meaningful moments and deepened relationships. The Gingham Apron Ladies, Denise, Jenny, Shelby, Annie, Molly. What Gathering Means to Us. Meet the authors. Annie. The Kingdom of God is an upside-down sort of place where the smallest and simplest efforts can make the biggest impact. And that's the principle I've seen affirmed as our family has simply gathered together. Our relationships and memories have been greatly increased and enriched. For this reason, gathering has come to mean working together to include the rich ways of God in our daily lives. Shelby. Getting together with family and friends around my parents' table was a frequent theme of my childhood. As the world continues to change, I feel an even stronger pull to gather together with others. Throughout the years and with the shift of my role into that of wife and mother, the meaning of gathering has evolved. To me, it's less about the agenda or food and more about those simple yet significant moments that weave us together. Gathering around the table is one way I can answer God's call for us to grow our relationships with one another. Molly. Gathering means intentionally connecting through our relationships by means of refreshment. This can be as modest as sipping coffee with a friend, or as lavish as a full-spread dinner party. When we do this, we are showing those we love that we desire to be together, and we have set aside this moment just for them, because they are worth it. God loves each of us and calls us to share His love. Through this practice, we express our honor and devotion to Him and one another, which fulfills and strengthens our relationships. Denise. The tools in our toolboxes of food, drink, a lighted candle, perhaps a vase of flowers, and good conversation set the stage for our family gatherings, even after our one-year experiment. That invitation to come gather and the feeling of belonging it offers are priceless. Through this practice of hospitality, we exhibit our love for each other and show we are available, we listen, and we care. Relishing time spent with others, I am drawn in to listen and to share as a piece of life unfolds. In gathering, I desire to simply reflect Christ's love for us all. Jenny. Gathering, to me, means getting together as a family, whether for fun or for something more serious. Gathering means important things are about to happen within our relationship building. We have the opportunity to build each other up in creative ways, to have real conversations, and take time out to really get to know one another and to help our family stay closely knit together. Encouragement is so helpful in our lives. More than anything, when our family gathers in one large group, it makes me think about how God loves us so much and how we show His love to each other. That's precious to me. Spring. Family picnic at the park. Intentionally unplugging. Strawberry lemonade, cucumber dip, tortellini pasta salad, roast beef spread, fresh fruit with almond sugar in a waffle bowl, strawberry shortcake. Shelby. It was a beautiful spring day when we gathered together for our family picnic at a local lake. This community lake is a perfect location for our family, with large grassy patches and mature shade trees lining the rock shore. We can easily throw some blankets on the ground and come together for our meal. A small playground with a big metal slide sits just steps away for the children to play, climb, and gain a bird's-eye glimpse of all the landscape just beginning to sprout its annual regrowth. Spring in Iowa is when the weather begins to warm up and new life returns. The men in our family undertake their annual sprint to plant this year's crop in our fields. On this particular day, the sun was bright as it warmed our cheeks, and the cool, gentle breeze reminded us of all the promises of spring. The kids played joyfully nearby. The girls went swinging on the playground and picked dandelions, while the boys hatched a new plan to capture the geese lingering near the shoreline. The day began to heat up as we managed to convince the kids to come to the blankets under the big shade trees for some lunch. We all sat together and enjoyed simple sandwiches and a few sides. The strawberry lemonade was extra popular and refreshing for the tiring kiddos. They soon caught a second wind and headed back out to explore the terrain while we cleaned up and moved out into the sun to enjoy its warmth and gain a better view of the activities and the scenery. While we Gingham Apron ladies were planning our year of gatherings, we knew that with the arrival of spring, we would want to plan something outdoors. We looked forward to the opportunity to enjoy the warmer days ahead and appreciate the beauty of the season. We also knew the urges to be on technology and the example we wanted to set for our children. We decided ahead of time to disconnect from our devices for the gathering that afternoon and deliberately engage with the people we were with and our natural surroundings. As Christians, we try to be intentional in our walk with the Lord. We desire a close relationship with Him. Just as we seek intentionality in our walk with the Lord, by reading our Bibles, attending church, and so forth, we also need to be intentional in our relationships with others. In our ever-changing world of technology, we have this amazing ability right at our fingertips to be globally connected. But being plugged in with so little effort makes it easy to stop being present with the people around us. As much as technology connects us, it also can isolate and disconnect us. Technology and social media can actually leave us feeling inadequate or unworthy and longing for a true connection, human connection to real and authentic people. What would it look like if we were to answer the command of loving our neighbor as ourselves, Luke chapter 10, verse 27, and try to be just as intentional in our relationships with others as we are to the Lord? To me, that would mean letting go of the distractions and fully embracing the people I am with, in part by putting my phone away while at dinner, remaining focused on our conversation, and inquiring about what is going on in others' lives. I would make them a priority, and once plans were set, I would stick to them. I would be sure to listen closely before speaking and show them respect. Our relationships with each other are a backbone of what we were made for. God gave us relationships to teach us how to mirror the kind of connection He wants with us. Our earthly relationships teach us. We grow from them, and we gain experiences that can strengthen our relationship with God and also encourage those around us to grow in their own walks with Him. Gathering outside together for a picnic without modern technology was a great reminder to take a deep breath and just slow down. We enjoyed the small moments, connected with each other, and soaked in the beauty of our surroundings. The day was a wonderful opportunity to be intentional and fulfill our mission of building relationships out among God's beautiful creation. A Place at His Table. Annie. Did you know that David wrote down Psalm 23, reflecting on nature and on being a shepherd, when he was already the king of Israel? Charles Spurgeon wrote, "I like to recall the fact that this psalm was probably written by David when he was a king. He had been a shepherd, and he was not ashamed of his former occupation." This was so impactful for me. Just think about it. As king, David was now rich. He lived in a palace, he had servants and treasures, and he was famous throughout his nation. Gone were his lowly days of sleeping with stinky sheep on chilly, dark, dangerous hillsides. But when he wanted to convey the messages of rest and restoration, peace and guidance, he wrote about green pastures and still waters. I've always loved Psalm 23. As a farm girl, when I picture a green pasture, I remember walks to our pond, riding horses and four-wheelers, and even checking on calves with my dad in the pastures of our farm. I know firsthand that pastures are places of beauty and quiet peace. And I know that one of the reasons I loved our picnic at the park so much was that we were able to gather outside on a lovely, calm, green, grassy knoll. I also treasure the image of still waters. I remember playing with my brothers in the creek behind our house, fishing and floating on inner tubes on our pond. And now I think about going with my kids to visit the serene lake that borders my parents' farm. Still waters are refreshing and restorative to my mind and well-being. During our picnic afternoon, the sunlight sparkled on and birds flew over the quiet lake nearby. David's metaphors of green pastures and still waters powerfully direct us to the impact of nature on our lives. Think about this. How does spending time in nature truly affect us? How does it help us to know God better and have more of Him in our lives? God's creativity. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of His hands. Psalm 19, verse 1. Just think about God's handiwork, His craftsmanship, the minute details He put into every living tree, delicate flower, and variegated blade of grass. I once read a science book to my kids that taught us how there are over 10,000 species of fish in the sea. Just fish! God's creativity is infinite, and when I spend time outside, I feel compelled to praise Him. God's power. Listen to this, Job. Stop and consider God's wonders. Do you know how God controls the clouds and makes His lightning flash? Do you know how the clouds hang poised? Those wonders of Him who has perfect knowledge. Job chapter 37, verses 14 through 16. When I go outside, when I am still and stop to consider the wonders around me, I am reminded that God is infinitely wise. He has made all things. He is holding all things together. Colossians chapter 1, verse 17. When I ponder the systems and seasons and remember that He is at work in it all, I am reminded that He can hold everything together in my life too. He knows what's best. His ways are perfect. This comforts me and gives me hope. God's sovereignty. But ask the animals, and they will teach you, or the birds in the sky, and they will teach you, or speak to the earth, and it will teach you, or let the fish in the sea inform you. Which of all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this? In His hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind. Job chapter 12, verses 7 through 10. When I spend time outside and notice all of the living plants and animals God sustains, I think about how He is truly in control. Right now in our area, millions of butterflies are migrating north from Mexico. How do they even know to do this? To me, they are just another reminder that God is in control. And when I think about how God is in control and I am not, this fact truly restores my soul. God's presence. Our culture is now a couple of decades deep into the constant usage of technology, and we are all aware of what the research is revealing. Studies show that people are more lonely, anxious, and discontent than ever before. Innately, we know, even without concrete studies, that being constantly stimulated and bombarded with information about other people leaves us with feelings of inadequacy and often despair. What if we were just still sometimes? Throughout the Bible are verses that guide us to look up, lift our eyes, and see. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? Psalm 121, verse 1. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Psalm 34, verse 8. Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? Isaiah chapter 40, verse 26. When we put our devices away and look at God's creation, we can lift our thoughts beyond other people, the problems in our lives, and the constant pressure to receive more information and be constantly available to the requests of others. I think David was on the right track when he shared with us the power and serenity of spending time in God's beautiful outdoors. Let's get outside today to enjoy the flowers, the trees, the breeze, or the twinkling stars. When we do, I know this promise will ring true in our hearts. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 23, verse 6. Key ingredients. Denise. When together. We show others we care dearly for them when we simply take the time to gather together and listen, really listen, while undistracted. A friend of mine, Gina, controls her phone. Her phone does not control her. When I am with Gina, her phone is nowhere in sight. There are no interruptions when we visit. I feel respected, special, and appreciated. She's listening to me completely, and our relationship builds. It's like a breath of fresh air for me. Yes, I know, this can't always be done. But the truth is, sometimes it can be done with a bit of effort and a few boundaries. We'll never be able to get rid of all our distractions and live in total peace, but with some careful planning and follow-through, our world can be transformed into something a little slower and more beautiful than its current cacophony of noise and distractions. What are some ways you can unplug with others? Practice putting your devices away during meal times. Talk about it. Turn everything off and enjoy the people around you. Talk about God. Bring up a topic and see where it leads you. Prayer and scripture at meal times are so meaningful, and fellowship fills the soul. Extend an invitation to a friend or loved one for a fun and simple picnic like ours, or to take a walk. Perhaps start by saying, "I'm going to unplug for an hour and I'd love to take a walk with you. When are you free?" Take a nature walk with children. They find so many treasures along the way. Don't forget to bring a bag. Take a stroll in a city park with walking paths and fun playground equipment. If you're with children, swing alongside them if you're able. Talk to the person you're with about their day, the best, the worst, the easy, and the hard. Go for a beach walk if you're near one, and dig for shells. Learn more about the area you live in with friends and loved ones. Invite a friend out to lunch. Keep your phone hidden and deliberately choose to listen with no interruptions. When at a meeting, church, and so forth, leave your phone in your car or another safe location. A scavenger hunt is a fun way to enjoy the backyard with all ages. Make it a competition if you can. Stargaze. We have a trampoline, so it's quite fun to fill it up with kids and adults alike. We check out the twinkly lights that God has not only created, but named. When alone. Shh. The world can wait. When I head out the door to take a walk on a nice day, the phone stays home and I go it alone. I choose to walk into a space of just God and me and His beautiful dome of creation. I journey to the top of the hill, way up on the ridge, and straddle a gate overlooking miles of countryside. The cattle low with their calves close by. The meadowlark sings on a nearby fence post, and I sing too. The beauty of the earth overwhelms me, and I cannot help but sing praises to the Maker of the heavens and the earth. What are some ways you can unplug? Take a long bubble bath. Silence the phone and place it in a location where you cannot hear it vibrate. Heavenly. Propose to look at your phone only at certain times of the day, if you can. Choose to multitask a little less. Watch some of the stress begin to diminish. Have your daily quiet time with the Lord, and make sure your devices are having a quiet time too. Jenny shares, I once went on a class field trip with kindergartners to a nearby park. The kindergartners learned a lot of neat things about nature. The highlight of the kids' day was that they saw a baby deer, the highlight of my day as well. I was reminded of the song, As the Deer, as I stared into the eyes of that spotted little creature. Just as the Bible says, we too thirst for God. He made us that way. We are most satisfied when we place Jesus Christ first in our lives and live for Him. Apron Application. Molly. 1. As you go through your day, what distractions can you eliminate to have the greatest amount of quality in your relationships? In what ways can you be more fully present in your relationship with the Lord? 2. When we intentionally unplug, what happens during this process? What do you notice? Ask God to help you become more aware of your distractions and set appropriate boundaries. 3. Make sure to carve out time for refreshment every day. How does this rejuvenate your soul? Prayer. Heavenly Father, I come to you with thanksgiving and appreciation of the beauty you have created. Please help me to intentionally notice the green pastures and quiet waters you provide. I thank you for this healing in my soul. Lord, I want to love with all of me and not just some of me. Please give me the strength to set aside more intentional time with you and my relationships and to become more aware of my distractions. In Jesus' name, amen. Gather at your table. Our picnic was delightful because we spread out heirloom quilts under shade trees and made a relaxed setting for us to eat slowly and linger over conversation. Shelby had the idea to make an unplugged container, which encouraged everyone to place their cell phone aside during the meal. We specifically chose a flat, grassy area so the kids could play catch and we could all take in the beauty of the lake. As you'll hear in the recipes that follow, we chose a light and refreshing menu that celebrated spring. To make sure the recipes were easy to eat outside on the go, we intentionally used fun containers, such as wooden berry baskets, small mason jars, and waffle bowls. Strawberry lemonade. Prep time, 10 minutes. Yield, 4 12 to 16 ounce servings. 1.5 cups fresh lemon juice, about 5 to 6 lemons, divided. 1.5 cups strawberries, trimmed and halved. 1 cup sugar, 4 cups cold water. Directions. 1. Juice lemons into a measuring cup, keeping as many seeds out as possible. 2. Puree strawberries with 2 tablespoons lemon juice in a blender until smooth. Then use a wooden spoon to force mixture through a fine sieve into a bowl to remove seeds. 3. Mix together puree, remaining lemon juice, sugar, and water in a large pitcher until sugar is dissolved. 4. Taste and add more sugar or water to desired flavor. Serve over ice. Can be prepared ahead of time and stored in a refrigerated airtight pitcher for up to 3 days. Cucumber dip. Prep time 10 to 15 minutes. Yield 8 servings. 3 large cucumbers, seeded and diced. 1 tomato, diced. 1 bell pepper, diced. 1 to 2 bunches green onions, thinly sliced on the diagonal, or substitute 1 teaspoon onion salt. 2 cups cheddar or Colby Jack cheese, shredded. 3/4 cup green goddess salad dressing. 1/2 teaspoon garlic salt or garlic powder. Salt and pepper to taste. Directions. 1. In a large mixing bowl, combine all ingredients well and chill until serving. 2. Serve with tortilla chips or pita chips, or alone as a salad. Tortellini pasta salad. Prep time 25 minutes. Cook time 15 minutes. Yield 10 to 12 servings. For the salad, 2 cups fresh snow peas, 2 cups broccoli florets, 2 cups button mushrooms, sliced, 2.5 cups cherry tomatoes, halved, 1 6-ounce can black olives, drained, 8 ounces cheese-stuffed tortellini, 3 ounces fettuccine, uncooked, 1 tablespoon Parmesan cheese, grated. For the dressing, 1/2 cup green onions, sliced, 1/3 cup red wine vinegar, 1/3 cup olive oil, 2 tablespoons fresh parsley, chopped, 2 cloves garlic, minced, 2 teaspoons dried basil, 1 teaspoon dried dill weed, 1 teaspoon salt, 1/2 teaspoon pepper, 1/2 teaspoon sugar, 1/2 teaspoon dried oregano, 1 1/2 teaspoon Dijon mustard. Directions. 1. In a large pot, boil snow peas and broccoli for 1 minute. Drain and let cool. When at room temperature, combine peas and broccoli with mushrooms, tomatoes, and olives in a large bowl. 2. Cook tortellini and fettuccine according to package directions. Drain and cool. 3. Combine cooled pasta with vegetables. 4. Mix together all ingredients for dressing. Shake well in a tightly covered jar. A pint jar works well for this, or other container. Pour over tortellini and vegetables and toss well. 5. Chill several hours before serving. Garnish with Parmesan cheese. Roast beef spread. Prep time 10 minutes. Yield 6 to 8 servings. 4 cups roast beef, sliced and roughly chopped. 2 tablespoons dill pickle relish or coarsely chopped fresh dill pickles. Dash garlic powder. 1/2 cup mayonnaise, plus more if desired. Directions. Mix all ingredients together and spread on crackers, buns, or hard rolls. Note: this is a great way to use up leftover roast beef. Fresh fruit with almond sugar in a waffle bowl. Prep time, 15 minutes. Yield, 12 servings. 1 pint strawberries, trimmed and halved. 1 pineapple, peeled, cored, and cut into bite-sized chunks. 2 peaches.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.